pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Over the past 2 months, we've lost an unusually high number of our fellow parishioners. Our community is grieving, struggling to come to terms with the fact that there are many familiar and beloved faces that we're not going to be seeing again in this life. Grieving isn't simply a case of being deeply sad. It comes with all sorts of other emotions, and invariably it comes with regrets. I'm sure we've all experienced what I'm talking about, the unfinished conversations, the questions that you've always meant to ask but never got around to, the untold stories, the expressions of appreciation that somehow remained unshared, the unresolved conflicts, so many wasted opportunities, including often the opportunity to say goodbye. When death comes, there's almost always unfinished business. Well, the rich man in our gospel passage learned the hard way that there was unfinished business in his own life. And by the way, this parable is only found in Luke's gospel, and it follows on from several other lessons that Jesus taught about how we deal with our treasure on earth and the treasure that we store up in heaven. The rich man of the parable was extremely rich. We can tell that by his wardrobe, his eating habits, and his property. Anyone who wore purple cloth in those days had to be wealthy because purple dye was very rare and very costly. Fine linen was also a great luxury, and this man wore both fine linen and purple cloth. He also enjoyed sumptuous feasts, and not just for special occasions either. On a daily basis, he would eat and drink in abundance. He probably had regular mealtime entertainment as well, because the Greek verb used for feasting is the same one Luke used to say, eat, drink, and be merry. And all of this sartorial and gastronomic excess took place in a home so grand that it had a gate at least one of its entrances. The Greek word indicates a large gate, the kind of gate you would see in a palace or even a city wall. So the man was hugely wealthy and hugely satisfied with his life. It's obvious that he had no problem spending his money and that his top priority was his personal comfort. Luke doesn't tell us that the man was malicious in any way, but he does make it clear that the man couldn't see beyond his own self-interest. I doubt very much that he spent all of his time at home, quite the opposite probably, because he must have wanted to display his wealth in public. So it's likely then that he went through his gate on numerous occasions. And yet, he appears not to have noticed the poor man, Lazarus, lying there, starving and diseased. So the rich man in today's parable uses his money for his own selfish gratification while practically under his nose another man suffers miserably and is ignored. And if we look at a couple of earlier stories in Luke's gospel, we'll see some other attitudes to money that Jesus identifies. The shrewd manager in last week's gospel, for example, worked out how to use money to win friends and influence people. his grand acts and largesse may have appeared generous, but like the rich man, the manager really only cared about himself. He was prepared to go to any length to ensure that he landed on his feet. If only, Jesus can be heard musing throughout that text, if only we were willing to put that much care into nurturing relationships for the good of God's kingdom. In the previous chapter of Luke's Gospel, we find that familiar story of the prodigal son. At first glance, it's another tale of profligate spending for selfish reasons. But there's more than one person in that story whose attitude to money is revealed. The elder son, who stayed at home with his father, and whose half of the considerable inheritance presumably remained intact. He resents every penny his father spends on his younger son when he returns home destitute. In this scenario, Jesus clearly longs for us to recognize the blessings that are poured out freely on all God's children. In that same spirit of unconditional love, God welcomes us back with joy, no matter how wayward we may be. And we are called to be equally generous with one another. So Jesus had already stunned his followers by suggesting that a respectable Jewish patriarch would welcome a son who wasted his money and lived among Gentiles. Jesus had already bemused his followers by using an example of dishonest dealings to illustrate a heavenly concept. And now, with his parable of the rich man and Lazarus, Jesus was shattering a fundamental belief held by the people of his time. In ancient Israel, wealth was seen as a sign of tremendous blessing, as undeniable proof of righteousness in the sight of God. And yet, as we move into the second part of the parable, Jesus turns this perspective upside down. Lazarus, the poor man, covered with sores, dies and is transported by angels into the presence of Father Abraham. The rich man, with his designer clothes and full belly, dies and finds himself in agony and torment in a fiery hell. Apparently, wealth does not guarantee eternal bliss after all. Oops. So, where did the rich man go wrong? Abraham has the answer, and he seems to break it to him very gently. Child, he says, in a kind, fatherly voice, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus, in like manner, evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Was the rich man being punished simply for being rich? I don't think that was Jesus' point at all. After all, Abraham himself was an incredibly wealthy man, as well as being hugely blessed and beloved by God. The rich man's mistake was how he chose to use his riches. And we already know that it was all about him, that he never spared a thought for the pauper at his gate. And on the subject of that pauper, the story makes it clear that Lazarus longed to be fed even scraps from the rich man's table. And I think we can safely assume that he never got any of those. But was the rich man really unaware of Lazarus' existence? Take another look at the gospel passage. When the rich man looked up from Hades and saw Abraham and Lazarus far away, he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue." He knew Lazarus' name. Far from passing by the poor man at his gate without even noticing him, the rich man knew he was there, knew him by name, and yet chose to ignore him. This adds a whole new dimension to the story and to the attitude to wealth that Jesus is addressing. There's no shame in having wealth. There's no shame in using wealth for nice clothes, good food, and comfortable homes. Where the shame comes in is when we use all our wealth for our own benefit. Where the shame comes in is when we recognize the enormous need around us, when we can call it by name, and yet we do nothing to alleviate it. We may not have a poor man lying in the entrance to our home, but we have homeless people on the streets of our city. We may not have a starving stranger longing for the scraps that we put down our waste disposals, but we have families filling the waiting room of our food pantry downstairs. We may never encounter a person covered with sores, but every year our prescription assistance ministry funds thousands of dollars worth of prescriptions for life-threatening illnesses and conditions. Our building itself has expenses that we often struggle to meet, which has a knock-on effect on all aspects of our ministry and mission. And beyond these walls, there are so many more needs that we notice, that come to our attention on a daily basis, and yet we can find it so difficult to respond open-heartedly. When the rich man realized what a mistake he'd made in the way he'd lived his life, he begged Abraham to send Lazarus to warn his five brothers so that they wouldn't all make the same mistake. But Abraham replied that the rich man and all his family had been hearing the teachings of Moses and the prophets all their lives, but they hadn't paid any attention. So, why should it be any different, even if someone were to rise from the dead, to urge them to change their ways? What about us? Someone did rise from the dead to urge us to change our ways. Are we listening? Amen.